It's rolling? Okay. All right. So you know what? Some other kids might come in, but we'll go ahead and get started since we have a good cadre of students that are here. And Sean is telling me that, you know, that this will be uploaded tomorrow sometime. I'll send you the link. It'll be the same link as the last one.
It's all part of the same playlist.
Yeah, so I'll send you the link tomorrow if you want to watch it over again, or, you know, for the other students in there. But when we started our conversation that this test is going to be a part of, we started with a discussion of the commonalities that the American colonies had as a part of the British Empire, right? So prior to this conversation, we had talked about how these colonies were like haphazardly established without really any kind of design by different people for different motives, and different people went there. And as a result, these colonies were different in a lot of ways. And we had made a case for the differences in these colonies, which raised a question. And the question was, if they were so different, how is it that they are going to unify and seek independence? And so we said, well, look, you know, there's got to be some things that are common among the 13 colonies, some things that represent an emerging kind of American experience. And so in chapter 5 in your textbook, we were talking about those things. And some of the things that were mentioned there were, one of the things that was mentioned there was a rapidly growing population. That by 1700, and that's where we are chronologically. You know, we said, look, the 16th century, right? The 16th century, the 1600s, was the time period in which these colonies were established. The 17th century, right, is when these colonies began to develop. Right? So 1700 to 1776 is the time frame that we were kind of talking about. We said in that time frame, all of the colonies' population grew rapidly. And we talked about some of the reasons why that population grew. And one of the things, I don't know if you remember, this was a revelation for you kids, but we put in the middle of the board, you know, the word land. And then we said, well, look, land accounted for, you know, people having more children because they married earlier. Land accounted for, you know, people dying or living longer because they weren't jammed in together. And we said that land also accounted for rapid immigration, people coming in. And that was another thing that we talked about in that chapter, and that was, you know, the multicultural nature of the population of colonial America. And we talked about immigration. And we said that the biggest immigrant group to come to colonial America were in fact the Africans. But after the Africans, we said that some of the other groups to come were the Scots-Irish and the Germans, and they came in large numbers. And we talked a little bit about this ethnic diversity. And we said that, look, the middle colonies were the most ethnically diverse. And we said New England was the least ethnically diverse. And the reason that New England was the least ethnically diverse is that most of the people in New England that went there during the Great Migration. That was 1630 to 1640. And that group of people basically naturally reproduced a population that would populate New England. That you know, by the turn of the century, people had no reason to migrate to New England. You know, the middle colonies, Pennsylvania was founded in the 1670s, and New York was founded in 1664. And when those colonies opened, as well as New Jersey and Delaware, there was more widely available land. So that immigrants that were coming from England and other parts of Europe were more likely to go to those middle colonies. So half the people in Pennsylvania were non-English. They were the most ethnically diverse colonies. And we talked a little bit about that. We also mentioned this, that look, regardless of where, you know, people were in colonial America, most of them were farmers. Most of them lived and worked on farms. Colonial cities were relatively small. Their populations were relatively small. And this is one of the reasons that the British have later, you know, we talked about this later, you know, when we talked about the Revolution, we said, look, during the Revolutionary War, Britain took Boston, they took New York, They took Philadelphia. They took Charleston. You know, they took every major city in, well, I shouldn't say that, but I mean the big major cities in colonial America, but it doesn't have any kind of impact on the war. You know, I mean, because these cities were relatively small and most of the population lived outside these cities and most of the population was involved in agriculture. So we talked a little bit about that, and then we talked at a little more length about religion. And we said, in colonial America, most people practiced a variation of Protestant Christianity. That the Church of England was established in several of the colonies and had influence there. The Puritan Church, which was called the Congregationalist Church, was established in New England with the exception of Rhode Island. And we said, for the most part, religion was of some importance in colonial America. But by the turn of the 18th century, right, colonial religious fervor was declining. And it set the stage for a pretty significant religious revival called the Great Awakening, right? And so we talked a little bit about religion in colonial America, but we spent a lot more time talking about the Great Awakening. We identified two people with the Great Awakening, two names we identify with the Great Awakening. Who were they? Go ahead, Braxton. Jonathan Edwards, we said, was one of the people that we associated with the Great Awakening. He was the theologian of it, yes? George Whitefield was the evangelist, the itinerant evangelist that traveled from place to place, and Whitefield is going to become famous. Remember we made the argument that Whitefield was the first American superstar, the first American that people kind of all knew, and that his evangelical tour that started in 1739 and lasted until 1741 was the first shared experience that Americans ever had. I mean, look, you know, his tour was something that many, many Americans have participated, the meetings that he had. And we talked a little bit about the nature of the Great Awakening. And we said that what the Great Awakening was a response to was a diminishing kind of religious fervor and an intellectualism that seemed to seep into religion, rationalism that seemed to seep into religion. You know, the ideas of the Enlightenment that we talked about that seemed to seep into religion. And that people like Edwards and Whitefield argued that it wasn't enough to kind of sort of intellectually understand salvation and grace, that you had to feel it. So they appealed to, rather than appealing to intellect, they appealed in their sermons to emotion, which is something that doesn't require intellect to sort of understand. I mean, I think there was a lot in some of the things that you read about the revolution of the importance of kind of putting revolutionary ideas in kind of the same terminology as the Great Awakening, right? You know, where you kind of appeal to people's emotions about this. And the methodology of the Great Awakening, you know, was something that was employed by ministers in promoting revolutionary ideas. So we talked a little bit about, you know, that. And we also talked about the results of the Great Awakening. And one of the results of the Great Awakening was the division between old lights and new lights. And the new lights were those who embraced the ideas and the methodology of the awakening. And the old lights were those who began to become suspicious of it. You know, we talked about another aspect of the Great Awakening was challenging authority. You know, the ministers, the awakened ministers, the New Light ministers challenged the authority of the learned clergy. And whether this kind of establishes a precedent for the revolution. In that same chapter 5, there is a discussion about freedom of the press. There's a discussion in there about education, you know, and we talked about education, and we talked about how New England led the way in public education and why, how that was connected to a religion. But there's also a discussion, I asked a question here, and I really didn't talk about it in class. So take a look in chapter 5, in that discussion about freedom of the press, you know, in chapter 5. So now, we in this chapter 5 that we're talking about, and there's at least 10 questions of the 50, exactly 10 questions of the 50 that come out of chapter 5 in your textbook. And the thing about those questions is there's not a narrative. The thing about the chapter is there's not a narrative to kind of guide it, right? You know, if we go to chapter 6 in your book, it's about the French and Indian War, which there's a narrative, right? There's a beginning of the war and, you know, a fighting of the war, the end of the war, and the narrative that kind of holds it together is the story of the war. It's not the case in chapter 5. Just talking about topics, right? You know, talking about population growth. We're talking about religion. We're talking about ethnicity and religious area and ethnic diversity. You know, we're talking about immigration. And all of these things fall under the kind of heading of things that are emerging as kind of an American way of life, right? So one of the things that we didn't talk about was freedom of the press, and that's something that you're going to look at in that chapter. One of the things that we concluded with in talking about that was government. And remember, we made the case that of all the things that the colonies held in common, right? You know, or I should put it another way. All of the areas that the colonies were different, right? One of the things that they held in common most prominently was ideas about government, right? And maybe this is what explains the popularity of natural rights as a reason for the revolution, because all of these colonies accepted the British system of government. And we explained that British system of government. We said, you know, look, there's the government of the one, the monarchy, the government of the few, the aristocracy, and the government of the many, the democracy. So monarchy, aristocracy, democracy, right? Three kind of types of government that were all embodied in the British system, with a king, a parliament with a House of Lords, and a parliament with a House of Commons, right? And that colonial governments replicated this. That each colony had a governor, monarchy, a governor's upper council, you know, or the upper house or governor's council, aristocracy, and a lower house, democracy, right? That the British system was installed in, right? And the idea that people in this British system had natural rights was something that colonial Americans were familiar with and bought into. I mean, it wasn't as if colonial Virginia said, oh my goodness, natural rights, that's a Massachusetts thing, right? Not at all. You know, the colonists all had a sense of what they understood the British system of government to entail, and the rights that they enjoyed as freeborn British subjects. And part of the revolution is going to be kind of their argument that those rights are being violated, right? But this was a core commonality that they had. And we talked a little bit about governors in these colonies and the struggles that they had and the fact that these governors were paid by the legislatures, and the legislatures often used those salaries, you know, as leverage against these governors, and how as time went by, the lower houses in these colonies are going to get more and more powerful at the expense of the governors in the upper houses. And by the time of the revolution, these lower houses in colonial America had basically taken control of all the colonies. The royal governors that had been appointed, or the proprietary governors that had been appointed, were gone, right? So we talked a little bit about that. And then we got into the conflict between England and her allies, and France and her allies, which fought four wars for empire. That was chapter 6 in the textbook, right? The wars between England and France. Remember we read that article from the Virginia Gazette? Remember we read that? How interested the kids. Troy, remember how interested you were when we read that article? You were fascinated by that article and how we argued. We didn't know much about the Virginia Gazette, but it made sense that the Virginians would publish an anti-French sort of newspaper because it was in the middle of four wars for empire. And what we said is that the first three of those four wars were started outside of North America, were largely fought outside of North America, even though in all four of them there was fighting in North America. But the fourth war for empire is going to start in North America, in where we live now, Western Pennsylvania, over the Ohio Valley and its importance there. And we talked a little bit about, you know, Washington. There won't be any questions on the test about, you know, Washington's journey here. And that was just interesting things that we talked about. But there will be a question on the test about the Albany Congress. What was that? What was the Albany Congress, and why would that be so significant? You know, that's part of the French and Indian War. Remember, shots are fired at Fort Necessity, you know, in 54, and later that summer, Britain, you know, calls, you know, representatives from all the colonies to convene in Albany, New York, for the purpose of kind of soliciting the Iroquois on their side. But Franklin takes it further. What does Franklin propose at Albany that is so darn interesting and important in our conversation? Why should a super genius yell this word?
For the colonies to unite and fight against?
Yes, he proposes a plan for union, a union of the colonies, right? Now I should tell you that later in the First Continental Congress, Joseph Galloway is going to propose the same kind of plan, right? You know, the Albany plan was to create a grand council of representatives from all the colonies that would, yeah, it was 54.
Who proposed that plan?
Franklin, in 54 in Albany. So that proposal was that all the colonies would send their representatives to a grand council, and that grand council would be an intercolonial government. So I was thinking about this, and Naomi, I know the kids don't think about it, but I was thinking about this. The Albany plan that Franklin proposes is accepted by all the people that go to the meeting, but eventually rejected by all the colonial legislatures and by Britain. Galloway, in the First Continental Congress, proposed the Galloway plan, which was similar to the Albany plan. And then, after Saratoga, right after the Battle of Saratoga, the British actually proposed a continental, you know, a Continental Congress. Basically, that's the Continental Congress is a version of Ben Franklin's Albany plan, right? You know, the British proposed a similar thing. But what was significant about Franklin's proposal is its rejection, right? That colonial Americans were unwilling, you know, the actual legislatures were unwilling to surrender any sovereignty, any of their local sovereignty to a colonial council, even when they were faced with the danger of the French and the Native Americans on their frontier, which we said was really kind of remarkable, right? You know, so the Albany Plan, the rejection of the Albany Plan was a big deal. Now, you know, we talked about, you know, a little bit of the fighting in the French and Indian War and Braddock's defeat and things of that nature, but you know, eventually we got to France's, you know, defeat. That William Pitt reorganizes the war effort, spends recklessly in doing so. Do you get the connection now? Why did Britain need so much money in the aftermath of the French and Indian War? Is, you know, they needed so much money because Pitt had spent so recklessly to win the war, right? He had expended a lot of funds, particularly in colonial America. So now you can see why the British are saying, well, look, you know, William Pitt spent all this money in colonial America to win this war. It started here, it's for you, and now we want you to contribute a little bit to it, right? And America said, oh, no, we can't do that, right? We can't do that. You know, it's a matter of principle, right? So anyways, you know, the peace arrangements, what's the most significant thing about the Treaty of Paris 1763, the peace agreement that ends the French and Indian War? What's the most significant thing about that? What's the biggest deal? Right, yes. Yes, French cedes its entire North American empire. Now, Britain doesn't get all of it, right? Some of it goes to Spain. But France gives up everything in North America, all gone, right? Their whole North American empire. Now remember, this is when we were all excited. Remember we talked about the aftermath of the French and Indian War, and France is gone, and there was this discussion in England about whether or not, you know, Britain should take Canada, you know, take all of New France, or take Martinique and Guadeloupe, you know, and, you know, there was some fear that if Canada was gone, colonial Americans would someday unify and declare themselves independent. And Franklin said, not only is a union amongst the colonies improbable, it is impossible. Right, and he says this in 1763 at the end of the French and Indian War. And remember we said 13 years later, what Franklin, you know, argued to be improbable, not just improbable, impossible, actually transpires. You know, the colonists do unify and seek their independence, right? Now, I should tell you that part of, you know, the road to kind of discord between Britain and colonial America occurs during the war itself. You know, Britain is not satisfied with the American support of their war effort. They are frustrated by colonial Americans' kind of performance in battle, that colonial Americans are not trained soldiers, that they would prefer to hide behind trees than to march into fire. They are not happy with colonial Americans' trade with the enemy during the war. And so Britain becomes increasingly disenchanted with the behavior of colonial Americans during the war. And they're also frustrated by colonial Americans' disregard for the mercantilistic legislation and their prosperity. So here are these colonies that are kind of riding high, that aren't supporting vigorously this war effort in our view, right? And, you know, they're benefiting from their participation in the, they're benefiting from our efforts in the empire, but they're not contributing to it at all, right? So this is, no, Americans for their part are kind of put off by what they consider to be British arrogance, you know, looking down at colonial Americans, you know, dictating to them after they were used to some measure of governing themselves. And probably a fairly good example of this is the proclamation of 1763. Oh what was the proclamation of 1763? Go ahead, Harry. Yes, it was a proclamation by Parliament, right, that settlers were not allowed to cross an imaginary line that ran through the Appalachian Mountains. Now, why, Margolis, was this such a source of frustration to colonial Americans?
Because they just wanted to fight the French.
Nicely put. They had just participated in a war that was intended to seize this area for France. They had staked claims there, and in some cases they already had property there, and they were forced to go back over the Appalachian Mountains, right? So there was a practical element. What was the political element of it? You know, I mean, there's kind of an, I don't know how many of you made this case, but there's kind of an economic element to this. Hey, I'm losing land, right, that I could prosper from. Now I'm not going to be able to prosper. What's the political element? Go ahead, Harry. From the American side. Politics is always a matter of power, right? Go ahead. True, but what do they resent? Yes.
Say,
yes, can you tell us to do this? Can you really dictate from across the ocean that we cannot take advantage of this land? Right, can you tell us to do that? I mean, that's the political issue. The economic issue is, if you tell us to do this, we're going to lose money. And really what I wanted you to do on that paper that I asked you to write is try to discern, you know, what was more important to colonial Americans in rebelling, the economic elements of things or the political elements of things. And most of you said the political elements of things. But making that case was sort of important. But anyways, okay, what the British, why did they do that? Why, what was the prompting reason for the proclamation? Go ahead, Jordan.
There was too many fights between Native Americans and the American settlers, so they thought we should just get this in the bottom and get the settlers to not go over there so they wouldn't be able to fight.
Yes, it was the conflict between those settlers and the Native Americans. And what was the real kind of big conflict that we talked about? And we talked about this in terms of Bushy Run. Go ahead, Kevin. Remember we talked about the Bushy Run battle? Go ahead.
Pontiac's
Rebellion. So the prelude to this was Pontiac's Rebellion. Here, with Pontiac's Rebellion, the Native American tribes, you know, that are feeling kind of isolated with the departure of France and fearful because of the nature of British colonization, are going to unify and try to push the British back over the Appalachian Mountains, right? And so the British response to Pontiac's Rebellion is kind of the proclamation of 1763. Let's take a break in settlement there and try to make agreements with the Native Americans and try to funnel new settlers into Florida and Canada and keep this open, act trade agreements, and make money like the French did from the Native Americans. Obviously, this was not something that Americans thought well of. You know, now, upon talking about, the Proclamation of 1763, we had a larger conversation about the challenges that Britain faced in the aftermath of the fourth and final war for empire, the 7 years war with the French and Indian War. And we said one of them was dealing with territories, like the territories west of the Appalachians. The other was tightening up on mercantilism. We mentioned mercantilism today. What did we say the goal of mercantilism was? Remember we mentioned this a number of times. The goal of a mercantilistic system was what? Who will finish that sentence? Yes. A favorable balance of trade, correct? Which means that you export more than you import. Now, how was that achieved in a mercantilistic system? How would you promote a favorable balance of trade? How was that achieved? And this is the heart of mercantilism. How do you get that? What do you do to get it? Go ahead, do it. Do it, Farron. Boston. Go ahead, Kevin. Help your ex-friend Farron out. I'm looking for something, and maybe the question isn't soliciting the answer I'm looking for. That the empire would regulate colonial trade, right? I mean, so in order to get a favorable balance of trade, they pass laws that would promote that, right? That would regulate what the colonists could do, who they could sell to, who they could buy from. You know, it would regulate. Now, just for fun, what's the difference between a mercantilistic system and capitalism? What's the difference? We talked about this today. Yes, go ahead.
Like mercantilism is to benefit the union or the country, and then capitalism is to benefit like oneself or.
You, Margolis, are a genius. Yes, you are. Margolis, he whispered it because he was afraid it might not be right, but he was correct, right? He was correct. He said, mercantilism is for the empire, right? So laws and rules are made in order to promote the prosperity of the empire. And so people should economically behave in a manner that benefits the empire. Capitalism, right, people behave in a manner that benefits themselves. Right? You know, it's self-serving. Self-interest is what drives people, not the interest of the empire. Now, capitalism is natural. Mercantilism isn't natural. So in order to get people to behave the way they needed to in mercantilism, laws had to be passed to regulate economic activity. What was the first set of laws passed in the 1660s that were intended to enforce mercantilism. Go ahead. The Navigation Act. And it was those Navigation Acts that had been ignored for so long, right? Ignoring the Navigation Acts, not enforcing them for 100 years was called what? What did we call this?
Salutary
neglect. And so what Britain is going to try to do in the aftermath of the French and Indian War is to kind of, you know, reject salutary neglect and tighten up on mercantilism. And we talked about how ways that they did that, you know, with the writs of assistance and the admiralty courts. And we talked about the Sugar Act. And we talked about the Sugar Act having two elements to it. One element was, right, modifying the tax on sugar. Another element was tightening up on the enforcement of the tax. But the stated purpose of the Sugar Act was to generate revenue for Britain. Now, this notion of generating revenue for Britain with taxation is going to be there with the sugar tax, it's going to be there with the stamp tax, and it's going to be there with the Townsend duties. And the tax on tea is merely one of the Townsend duties, right? Now, colonial Americans are going to reject the idea of taxation for the purpose of revenue as a violation of their natural rights. So colonial Americans are going to say, hey, look, you can tax us to regulate trade. At least at first they're going to say that. Eventually they're not even going to admit to that. But at first they're going to say, you can tax us for the purpose of regulating trade, but you can't tax us for the purpose of generating revenue. Hence, the Sugar Act, the Stamp Act, and the Townsend duties all represent taxation without representation, which is tyranny, right? The reason you can't tax us for the purpose of generating revenue is because the parliament that is levying the tax has no colonial representation. Hence, this is taxation without representation and represents a violation of our natural rights. And, you know, we talked about that at length, you know, this argument. Right? And some of you tried to use that in your papers with varying levels of success, right? I mean, I don't think it was enough to say the colonists rejected the Stamp Act because they said it was taxation without representation. Hence, it was political. I don't think that was enough, right? I think that you had to somehow prove that their rejection was political, right? I don't think it was enough just to say it. Right? I mean, obviously, you have to say it. What was the British reaction to stamp it, to taxation without representation as tyranny, taxation without representation as theft? These taxes are, you know, a violation of our natural rights. What was the British response to that part? Yeah, go ahead. Perfect. They said, no. Everyone is virtually represented in the entire empire by Parliament, which the colonists are going to ultimately reject. The Declaratory Act is I mean, virtual representation and the Declaratory Act are connected. They are connected in that in the Declaratory Act, after the repeal of the Stamp Act, Parliament declares that Parliament is supreme in all areas whatsoever, right? How about representation? Everybody is represented. So therefore, we are supreme in all areas whatsoever. Okay. Now, in terms of taxation, there are kind of three crises that deal with taxation. The Stamp Act crisis, which ends when the Stamp Act is repealed. The Townsend Duties crisis, right, that ends after the Townsend duties are repealed, right? And the Tea Act crisis, which ends with the American Revolution. Now, in terms of the Townsend duties, you know, part of the narrative of the Townsend duties is that those Townsend duties were complicated. And they were basically trade taxes that were complicated to enforce and required a lot of customs officials in order to enforce them. And that swarming number of customs officials is what sets the stage for eventually the military occupation of Boston and eventually the Boston Massacre. But in the aftermath of the Boston Massacre, we said that there's a period of relative quiet because the Townsend duties are repealed except for the tax on tea. Why did they keep the tax on tea? What do we say? Go ahead, Victoria. Bingo. To show that Britain had the authority to tax and to basically get the colonists to capitulate to it. Now, I should say that many of you in your papers that you wrote used the Tea Act fairly effectively to make an argument. And it was an argument that we made, and you basically just repeated it in most cases. But some of you butchered that. Some of you butchered the Tea Act. You said that the Tea Act was part of the stamp. I mean, all kinds of, different things. But the Tea Act, or the Tea Tax, was the residual Townsend duty that remained. And the Tea Act, right, that was passed in 1773, was legislation that gave the British East India Company an exclusive monopoly over tea sales in colonial America, and would have resulted in a lower cost for tea, even with the tax. Right? So, obviously, colonial Americans rejected that, and it results in the Boston Tea Party. Now, before we get to that, all right, let's do this one. What's Britain's response to the Boston Tea Party? Go ahead, Harvey. What's Britain's response to the Boston Tea Party? The intolerable or the coercive acts. So the intolerable acts and the coercive acts are the same thing, right? The Americans call them the intolerable acts. The British called them the coercive acts. These were legislation that were passed in order to punish Boston for what they had done, right? What was the colonial response to the coercive acts? Yes.
It became united afterwards.
In what form?
In the form of one union.
No. The first.
Oh, Continental Congress.
First Continental Congress. The first Continental Congress was a response to the intolerable. Right. Tell me one thing that happened in that first Continental Congress. Anything. Yes. That didn't happen. They're not talking about independence in the first Continental Congress. Yeah. Go ahead, Farron.
They enforce boycotts on British goods.
Yeah. They have a Continental Association to boycott British goods. They reject the Galloway Plan, which is a version of Franklin's, Albany Plan, is giving them too much power. And they encourage, the colonies to arm themselves. Now, between the First and Second Continental Congress, what big event occurred that actually prompts the Second Continental Congress? It's a big event. Happens in between. Yes. Concord and like, hey Jordan, how about that day? Whoa. Was that big? Naomi, how about that day when we fired the shot heard around the world? That was one. You recorded it in your journal, didn't you, Troy? Yes, you did. I learned a lot in AP history. Dear Diary, I learned a lot in AP history today. Right? Yes, we talked about the Concord and Lexington blood being shed, and then convening the Second Continental Congress. What was the emphasis of the Second Continental Congress? What was happening in that Second Continental Congress? What was the big deal? I'm going to put it, when I say this, you'll get it. What was the big debate in the Second Continental Congress? The big debate was what? Yes. Yes. Whether or not to be independent. Right? And we talked about, how there was a strong faction of people that did not want to be independent. and what eventually leads to the decision of independence. And what did we identify as one of the biggest things that leads to the eventual decision to declare independence? What starts to turn the tide towards independence? Yes.
The classification of the events in the colonies as a rebellion.
Yeah, I mean that's a good place to start. Yeah, when the king rejects the olive branch petition and declares the colonists in a state of rebellion, you know that contributes to it. Lord Dunmore's you know proclamation, you know the hiring of the Hessians. But the big thing was what? Turns the tide of public opinion. January 1776. Yes.
Common Sense.
Common Sense, published by Thomas Paine. Now, meanwhile, you know, Washington was appointed to be commander-in-chief, and as this Congress was debating independence, Washington goes to Boston, takes over the war effort, right? But even by the time Washington got to Boston, remember we said the biggest battle of the war had already been fought at Bunker Hill, right, with the most casualties. But Washington takes over the war effort, you know, and, you know, the battle is fought. And then finally, we said, you know, the Declaration of Independence comes. And there's going to be a couple of questions on the test about the Declaration of Independence. You know, certainly the argument that's put forward in the Declaration of Independence would be something that you should be familiar with, right? That Jefferson and the committee were asked to explain why the Congress that represented colonial Americans was declaring the colonies to be independent. And his explanation involved, right, the idea of natural rights and equality, right? And to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. Right? To secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. And so then, obviously, the colonial American argument was that the British government was not only not securing these rights, but they were inhibiting these rights. And that this justified replacing that government with one that was more likely to ensure their safety and happiness, as Jefferson argued in the Declaration. We talked about who this was intended for, to explain to the world, to the European powers, to domestic Americans, to people in Britain, why they were doing what they were doing. You know, and the advantages that the Declaration had. Now, in terms of the fighting, we said that the Revolutionary War was fought in kind of three places. New England first, police actions, General Howe. The Middle Colonies second, right, pitched battles, or not General Howe, General Gage first, second General Howe. And then the South third, pacification. In all of that fighting, the only battle I want you to know, and I ask you a question on the test about this, is the Battle of Saratoga. Why would that be, Kevin, the battle that I want you to know?
Because it was a turning point that involved the colony of France.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, France is going to decide to enter the war on behalf of the United States and recognize the United States as a result of that victory. And so that's the one I want you to know. I mean, we also talked a little bit after we talked about the Declaration of Independence about loyalists versus patriots. And who the loyalists were, and what they typically, you know, what was typically true. What part of the where do you think the least loyalists were? What part of colonial America were the least? Yes.
Say New England.
Yes, New England had the least loyalists. Maybe the middle colonies or the South might have had the most, but the least was in New England. Now, two things that I didn't talk about in class that might be on the test. One is the role of the Native Americans in the West in the fighting. It's a brief part of texts about that. You know, we kind of alluded to that in first period a little bit today, that most Native Americans supported the British. There were some tribes that supported the colonists, but most supported the British because they thought they would have a better opportunity, you know, to preserve their status with the British. So that's why the Native Americans are really going to find an American victory not to be very good for them. So you would want to look at that. The other thing that you would want to look at is something called the Quebec Act. Now, the last thing on the test is the Treaty of Paris, 1783. And, you know, the details surrounding that, the fact that the Americans got fairly generous terms in that treaty, you know, largely because Britain was trying to drive a wedge between them and France, might be important. Now, Braxton asked me this question. He says, is there going to be anything about Zinn, Daigler, and Nash on the test? And the answer is yes. The last three questions on the test are going to be, and these are basically the bonus questions, are going to be quotes from each of their pieces. And who, I'm going to put the three guys there, and ask you to identify which one these came from. Now, I mean, these are not going to be obscure things, like, you know, that, I mean, they're going to be quotes that really embody their main ideas. So really what you should know is what we went over today. You know, that Zinn believed that it was, you know, the revolution was all an attempt by a disenfranchised elite to funnel the rebellious spirit of the poor against a British elite that was in control. That Daigler believed that, you know, the revolution was an attempt to maintain, you know, the development that had been occurring in colonial America that was different than what, you know, what was true in England. And that Nash believed that Americans joined this rebellion because they saw an opportunity to reinvent their lives, right? And you should be able, with the knowledge of that, to kind of properly identify. Okay. I think that's it for the test. So, okay, there you go. So that's that will be on Thursday. This will be on the YouTube tomorrow if you want to watch it again. But in the meantime, that's it. I'll see many of you tomorrow. Kevin, have you begun your extensive studies for this test yet?
Yeah, I've been looking at it.
I'm not going to do it. You don't have to turn that off. You don't know anything about turning it off. Thank you. Yes, you want to do it. I
think this is. Sorry.
Good.
My bad.